Yeah, Deepti, it has started. It is recording is on.
So just I'm checking Dr. Pan sir has joined.
Not yet. Please start. Go ahead.
Then I will start, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. So good morning everyone, and welcome to our webinar series 2021 and 22, organized by IEEE MTTE student branch chapter IITBH Varanasi and IEEE MTTE's young professional community. So today we have the webinar on microwave radiation safety standards vis-a-vis physiological basis by Dr. Subrat Kumar Dutta, who is the scientist at the Microwave Tube Research and Development Center, that is MTRDC, Bangalore, India. So now I would like to request Dr. Samok Bhattacharya to introduce our speaker, Dr. Subrat Kumar Dutta.
Okay, so good morning to all of you who are from India, and accordingly you can just change the particular, you know, that whatever I'm talking of. So yeah, so let me introduce the speaker. I'm sorry for being late for, you know, some kind of technical glitch. So Dr. Subrat Kumar Dutta received his BE degree in Electronics and Telecommunication Engineering in 1989 from Bengal Engineering College, Shibpur, India, and MTech and PhD degree in Microwave Engineering in 1991 and 1999 respectively from the IIT BHU Varanasi, India. He has bagged the prestigious INAE Young Engineer Award in 2001. He also has received Sir C.V. Raman Award for Young Scientists, Agni Award for Excellence in Self-Reliance, Science Day Silicon Medal, Technology Day Titanium Medal from DRDO, B.V. Baliga Memorial Award for Innovations from IETE. He is also served as the Golden Reviewer of IEEE Electron Device Society as well as DRDO Scientist of the Year in the year 2015. He is a member of the National Academy of Sciences, India. He is also a fellow of the IETE and Institute of Engineers of India and a senior member of IEEE. He is the founder, general secretary, and a fellow of the Vacuum Electron Devices and Application Society, that is VEDAS, in India. His current areas of research include computer-aided design and development of microwave tubes, biological effects of microwaves, and studies on electromagnetic wave propagation in microwave circuits. So without making any delay, let's welcome sir, and it's over to you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Bhattacharya, for your very affectionate introduction about me. Let me come to the topic. I thank Professor Bhattacharya and especially the MTTS Students Chapter of BHU to giving me a chance, opportunity to just present some ideas on the microwave radiation safety standards vis-a-vis the physiological basis, actually. Now, this particular module I designed, it is basically a course module or teaching module I designed for the service officers of Indian Army, Navy, and Air Force. And on several occasions, this module has been imparted to them to get some idea about the microwave safety, whatever they are supposed to exercise, basically for their learning and to get sensitized. Now, there is a very elaborate standard available from IEEE that spans over around some 350 pages. It is very difficult for somebody to go through it. And further, it is difficult to get the idea from that particular standard document, what is the basis for evolving the standard and how the standard has evolved, and what is the present limiting values or the envelope of the standard. So I have just tried to summarize those aspects in this particular talk, and we'll just try to give you a glimpse of it. Apart from that, towards the end of my talk, I have tried to keep, in recent last 1 week's time, you may be hearing some discussions or some reports from the media that Havana syndrome. Earlier it has been there, now it is coming in a big way that some US embassy persons have got affected by Havana syndrome in India and China or Pakistan, something like that. Okay, so towards that, some idea also I'll also try to give you that how it is and how does it happen. Now, with this small preamble, let me start the talk. Not able to present it, no? Yeah. Okay, let us go to the next slide. See, when we talk about that microwave radiation safety, let us first have a little glimpse on the EM spectrum, total electromagnetic spectrum. That the total electromagnetic spectrum, if we see, the wavelength varies, low frequency, longer wavelength, to high frequency, smaller wavelength. So obviously, when we see the low frequency, longer wavelength, that wavelength will be having a larger skin depth. That means very low frequency magnetic signal, these microwave signals, it will be able to penetrate our body. But whenever we go towards the high frequency signals, as we can see, the resonance frequencies or the wavelength in comparison to size, the microwave signals or RF signals are the size of our body itself, maybe around 5 to 6 feet wavelength. Then the moment we go to millimeter wave, it becomes the size of a honeybee or maybe something like a shirt button or a paper pin. So we can see the depth of penetration automatically will vary. So we will keep our discussion mainly focused on the RF and microwave signals, where the wavelength is around our body size or our limbs can be excited with the type of wavelength. So somewhere around 10 to the power 5 to 10 to the power 6, at the most 10 to the power 7, range, we'll keep our discussions focused. Next one, please. Now, when we go to this microwave radiation effects or radiation hazards, whatever we say, what is the nature? How it affects our body? Usually, we say there are two types of radiation hazards. One is ionizing hazard, another is non-ionizing hazard. Ionizing radiation, whatever we say, that is usually the very high energy, quantum energy or energy packets, whichever frequency it can carry. And it should be somewhere of the order of around 12 electron volt energy should be there. And for that, the wavelength should be very tiny, something of the order of 103 nanometer. So UV spectrum and above, this energy spectrum we call, whatever you have seen in the previous slide, is RF spectrum. That above ultraviolet spectrum or above this energy spectrum, we can call ionizing radiation. And for that type of radiations are getting affected by the alpha particles, beta particles. These are all particle or charged particle type of hazards. Otherwise, we can talk of the in the EM spectrum, X-rays or gamma rays type of EM waves also. So for that, some standard is there. That standard, I think, may not be very relevant for the present context. But just to tell you that, let us say that for general concept, we are going for the X-ray radiations for the medical treatments, or somebody is going for MRI, or somebody is going for some CT scan. Okay. So for common people, it is something like annual exposure of around 300 millirem. 300 millirem is something like 1 joule per kg or 1 sievert. That is the maximum tolerable limit our body can tolerate for annual exposure. So that something equivalent to around 4 CT scans in a year, the type of total dose or total cumulative dosage, whatever you are getting. So you can just think of, if anyone is undergoing more than 5 to 6 CT scans in a year, that is little bit dangerous from the tolerable limit of the standard for the X-ray radiation or gamma radiation. Now, coming to non-ionizing radiation, yes, those gamma or X radiations are ionizing radiations, means these radiations will be breaking, able to break the bonds or the chemical bonds in the cellular molecules. So when it breaks the chemical bonds, it can actually cause a permanent damage in the cell. So it can cause cancer. I'll come to that a few slides later in the discussion. But whatever our main interest is today is what I should say, that is a short duration exposure, non-ionizing radiation, and long duration exposure, non-ionizing radiation. So microwave radiations per se, whenever we talk, these radiations are actually non-ionizing. It is not having sufficient energy to break the chemical bond of the cellular molecules in the human body or any animal body. So it is mainly caused by the microwave heating. Let us go to the next. Microwave heating, how does it take place? I think for this audience, I need not dwell much on it. We know that most of our cellular molecules are dipoles, having dipole properties. So whenever it is getting superimposed with a time-varying electromagnetic field, these dipoles will be rotating or try to rotate. If the dipole is a free dipole, it will fully rotate according to the periodical change of the RF field, electric field. But because all the molecules in our body are fixed, something like a fixed molecule in a crystal lattice, so it will be having some amplitude and some damping also. So the damping plays a part. Whenever it is getting superimposed with a time-varying electric field, dipole will try to rotate. As the electric field rotates in the rotates orientation in the next RF cycle, so automatically some damping also is provided by the surrounding cells. So some heat is getting generated because of energy provided by the aligning electric field and a damping force. So that heat is basically microwave heating. So whenever our body is getting subjected to the time-varying microwave signal, in a very fast changing response for this microwave signal, our cell is trying to change its orientation, dipole orientation, and because of damping, the molecule and the surroundings get heated up. So microwave heating takes place. Let us go to the next. And the effects of microwave radiation is mostly this heating effect, what is getting created in our body. Now, all of us know that if heating takes place, it may cause some thermal runaway in the body. Does it happen? It doesn't happen. Because our body is having a fantastic, miraculous mechanism called homeostasis. I think many of you may be aware what is homeostasis, but just let me tell you a little introduction about homeostasis. Homeostasis is basically a total equilibrium maintaining mechanism in our body. Whenever our body is a balanced machine, I can say, created by the Almighty. So whenever a disturbance takes place in our body, wherever, let us say in our present context, we can say that somewhere our body temperature is going high. So whenever body temperature is going high, what is the tolerable body temperature we have in general? In general, we tell in terms of, let us say, centigrade or Celsius, 37 degrees Celsius, our body temperature has to be maintained around 37. Maximum, it can go to 39 degrees Celsius. And within that temperature range, our cells will be working without any degradation of the performance. Our brain will be working. All our major limbs also will be working at that particular temperature. So whenever the temperature in the body rises, immediately the signal will be coming from our thalamus or hypothalamus in the brain that body temperature is rising. Control it. Control it. That signal will go everywhere. And the signal will throw from the brain to the all the limbs to the peripheral nervous system. And immediately the blood glucose level will change, iron levels will change, all these ion levels will change, and body blood will rush to the surface of the body and whatever temperature rise is taking place, and it will try to take away the excess heat and try to keep the temperature regulation in control. If it doesn't happen, then sometimes our brain will tell that we have failed to control the homeostasis, so we are lifting up. So you will be declared as a brain dead. That is something called brain stroke. And finally, the heart will stop working. So that is the basic mechanism of homeostasis, how it works. So homeostasis actually helps us, like when we get exposed to very acrid sunlight, we'll be sweating profusely. I think in our normal biology classes up to class 10, we might have read it. All of us have read that why we that sweating takes place in our body. That is part of the homeostasis. Now, I think after this particular example, things are clear to all of us that how homeostasis works. It one of the activities of homeostasis is the temperature control, body core temperature control. So it does it. So if homeostasis is not there, temperature control in the body will not take place and body will revolt, or finally it will surrender to the stimuli that we are not able to manage. Next, please. And when homeostasis fails due to whatever reason, that may create some permanent damage in some of the genomes or genetic cells that in turn causes cancer. Because some genes are getting disturbed, then after the gene is getting disturbed, it will create some genetic mutation. And mutation, and when subsequently the gene gets multiplied in the body, that mutation will percolate further. Like whatever we are seeing, that RNA mutation is taking place for the COVID-19 virus. Same type of mutation may take place in our body if one gene gets disturbed. So that will finally end up with that malignant growth in the body and causing the cancer. Or if it is not even malignant growth, it can create some other cellular deformity which will be percolating to the body, and cancer will be spreading in the body, and that will be the end of life. Next. Okay, before going to further, so far we have told that microwave radiation hazard is mostly thermal, and our body tries to manage this thermal heating by a mechanism called homeostasis. And if homeostasis is not able to manage, that can be having a devastating effect, some short-term effect, or even that can be creating some chronic trouble like cancer also. So homeostasis or core temperature control is the basic mechanism for the microwave hazard mitigation for the body. So it is now, so far it is very clear that microwave radiation creates some heat in the body. Body has to manage the heat. So all standards, whenever it is getting evolved, finally the major standard, whatever is given or in vogue or it is very popular throughout the world, is IEEE standard. So IEEE standard only I'll address. Earlier it was called NCNIRP and or that ANSYS type of standard. Finally, it is taken over by IEEE and one unified standard is evolved. And what they're telling is what is the body's threshold limit. Now coming to that, how the standard has evolved. Now, whenever we buy a cell phone or we buy a microwave oven or we buy any communication setup, we always come across some terminology. I'll try to introduce those terminologies to you. Sometimes if you start reading it in the net, people gets confused. So maybe I'll try to just dispel the confusion and try to tell you what those terms mean and how the threshold levels are decided. For coming to that, let us come to our body. In our body, always some metabolic activities are taking place. That is some catabolism and metabolism, some metabolic activities taking place, catabolism, anabolism, that type of activities will be there. And both these activities will be generating some heat in our body. So whenever heat is generated in our body, that heat is again managed by the homeostasis. Our body has to be cooled. Like whenever we take some food, we get little sweating. Or if we get some heavy food, then we feel little warmth. That all of us know. That is because food is getting digested, it is going to our cells, and our body is producing some heat. That heat has to be cooled. So we feel that, yes, we are hot. So body responding to that additional energy whatever has come to your body. Now that whatever your body producing the heat, that is due to metabolism. So we call it is metabolic. Some metabolic rate is happening in your body. Now, what is your tolerable limit for the body? For that purpose, one limit is defined. It is a statistical process. It is called basal metabolic rate. I think those who have studied biology up to class 10th level, I think most of them would be knowing the word basal metabolic rate. What is basal metabolic rate? That is heat production of human body in a thermoneutral environment at around 33 degrees Celsius, at a rest mentally and physically, at a time exceeding 12 hours from the last meal. Because immediately after meal, metabolic activity is more. Metabolic rate of activity is more in our body. After 12, let us say night 8 o'clock, you have taken a meal, you had a good night, 8 to 10 hours sleep. At morning 8 o'clock, whatever is your body radiating the heat, that is known as the basal metabolic rate. On an average, it is defined that for a 84 watts, heat will be produced from a typical human body of 70 kg, around that works out to be around 1.2 watts per kg. And at that time, BMR outward heat flux from our body, if we take average heat flux, it will be around 10 milliwatts per cm square. Let us try to remember these two figures. These two figures will be coming continuously in the next some 20 to 25 slides, whatever I am trying to explain, tell you about the standards. So let us say our body, when it is at equilibrium state, at a steady state, at rest, so our body temperature balance is kept at around 10 milliwatts per cm square radiation. We talk of the halo effect of the body. Just little bit I'm digressing. Whatever is told that our ancient yogis and all, they used to be living together for a few months, for a few years altogether. You know, what they used to do, they used to reduce their metabolism in the body to the lowest minimum extent. Some literature tells that their basal metabolic rate used to be so less that whatever I am telling, that BMR outward heat flux, it is 10 milliwatts per cm square. This used to become a few microwatts per cm square. So you can just imagine a normal human being, whatever that heat produced with a metabolism at rest in your body is 10 milliwatts per cm square. That type of rate it is happening. Those yogis used to maintain that microwatt or nanowatt level. So obviously the metabolism is happening so slowly, the body would be something like almost dead, but some basic metabolism is taking place to keep the body just alive. So you will feel the body is cold, but life is still inside the body. And a similar type of phenomenon happens when some reptiles go for the hibernation, that you all know. Just I'm giving some exaggerated example. So that is the basic thing. Now, these two figures, let us remember, 1.2 watts per kg and 10 milliwatts per cm square. With this reference, let us try to progress now towards the standard for the radiation. We define the external source of radiation in such a way that how much external radiation our body can tolerate with respect to this basal metabolic rate. That external radiation we call, or external stimulus, radiation stimulus we call it as, that response to that radiation we call specific absorption rate. That is also in the same unit like BMR, watts per kg. So if our BMR is 1.2 watts per kg, how much additional radiation our body can tolerate? IEEE tells that maybe around 30% extra. So external stimulus, whatever our body can take in terms of SAR, that or BMR, that is watts per kg limit, let us take, it takes around 0.4 watts per kg. So when we tell specific absorption rate, now I think that after this slide, those who are attending it, whenever they see their cell phone, they will understand that when the cell phone reads the data sheet, that Samsung or this iPad, whenever tells that it is 0.79 watts per kg is the SAR value, that is quite well understood that it is 0.7 watts per kg with respect to our basal metabolic rate. I think, am I clear? If somebody can respond.
Yes, sir, it is okay. Please go ahead.
Okay, next. Now coming to the evolution of standards, we have seen 1.2 watts per kg, our basal metabolic rate, and that radiation from the body is 10 milliwatts per square centimeter, and 30% overhead our body can take. Apart from that, one more parameter is taken to decide the standard. That is, see, whatever energy whatever energy is illuminating our body, not that entire energy is getting absorbed inside the body. It will not be so. So after some experimentation and some empirical correction, it is considered that maximum 50% of the incident energy will be absorbed in the body tissues. So whenever I told that 10 milliwatts per square centimeter, 30% of is somewhere around 3 milliwatts of square centimeter. So effectively, our body would be able to tolerate around double that particular limit, that is around 6 milliwatts per square centimeter. But how long? How long would it be our body would be able to tolerate it? That is very critical. So what IEEE has worked out after some experimentation on the animals, that whatever usually we see in a hot sunny day, that 20 milliwatts per square centimeter of heat flux from the radiation of the sunlight causes around 1 degree Celsius temperature rise in the body per minute. Okay. Now, that shows that in 3 to 4 minutes time itself, our body temperature from 37 degrees Celsius, that is our normal body temperature, it will reach to a temperature of around 39-40 degrees Celsius, going to the dangerous limit of a heat stroke type of mechanism. So based on that, it is decided that whatever exposure we are getting, that exposure should not be more than 10% duty cycle or so. What is 10% duty cycle? That means over an hour time, if we take maximum 6 minutes, we can get exposed, and another 54 minutes our body needs to maintain the equilibrium through homeostasis. Just try to understand. I am again repeating it. Over an hour, 1 hour period, our body can tolerate the heating with the maximum limit, whatever we are telling, the maximum limit of the standard value of the radiation, our body can tolerate maximum 6 minutes if it gets a time of another 54 minutes to maintain the body's equilibrium through homeostasis. That is why I gave you some introduction about the homeostasis, that is the body's balancing mechanism. So for a heating of 6 minutes, body needs another 54 minutes time to create the equilibrium. Please keep in mind. Next, please. Oh, sorry, previous one, please, previous one. Now, this heating is again not uniform throughout the frequency band. If you see this corner plot, if you can see that somewhere around 100 megahertz frequency, the absorption in the body becomes maximum. You can see this peak, whatever is given in the IEEE standards document, that somewhere around 100 hertz, that is the FM frequency band, and some communication band also, whatever signals are there around us, those signals will be penetrating in our body maximum. And absorption in our body would be maximum around those signals of around 100 hertz. Let us go next. Next one, please. So let us come to these frequency bands, that is the standard frequency bands for AM radio, shortwave radio, TV band, FM radio. So this around 100, and if I take some 3 dB bandwidth, we are very, very we very aptly take the 3 dB bandwidth. No? So 3 dB bandwidth, if we take, that happens to be the FM radio bandwidth. Okay, around that bandwidth, whatever fixed signals are there, if signals are very strong signal, that will penetrate in our body maximum, and that will get absorbed in our body maximum and create maximum troubles. Let us go to next, please. These standards have been evolving since 1974. At 1974, when the these particular standards started evolving, as I have told, the basal metabolic rate, 10 milliwatts per cm square, that itself was taken as a standard, the maximum tolerable rate. At that time, scientists thought that, okay, our basal metabolic rate is 10 milliwatts per cm square. So maybe same limit, 100% limit, our body can consider. They didn't know at that time that homeostasis have some limit or some time they need for the cooling of the body. And it is, they have decided, as they decided it, that irrespective of the frequency, it should be same. That skin depth, the tissue depth, the dielectric constant of the tissues, those things were not well known at that time. That was the standard they decided. Let us go to next. So now when we think, and especially the members of this MTT team, those who are having who are the microwave expert, now you can think how primitive the standard is, how the absorption, dielectric constant, everything should be constant across the frequency. Very impractical. But some standard has to be kept in place. They have kept it. Then 82, it was revised. Then they accepted that resonance absorption takes place. Frequency dependency should be established. And at that time only, first, this specific absorption rate, whatever I am telling, that is 0.4 watts per kg. And over a period of 0.1 hour period, that point came. And this particular standard was evolved, nothing else than our own scientist, Dr. O.P. Gandhi, who was earlier in Sri Pilani. Then he migrated to US and he was heading that RF standards cell of IEEE at that time. And he was at the helm of deciding these standards. So let us say this is actually Gandhi standard, whatever is evolved at that time. Let us go to next. In 1991, they expanded the frequency band, and whatever 0.4 watts per kg was told earlier, that SAR value maximum tolerable over a period of or over an interval of 0.1 hour, that was again made in two levels. One for the professionals. Professionals are knowingly getting themselves exposed to RF radiation, but common people, they're unknowingly getting themselves exposed. They don't know how long they are getting exposed. So for the common people, the standard was again made actually 1/20th. Okay, so it was made 0.08 watts per kg or 0.1 hour interval. Next, please. Then in 2005, and they accepted the RF shock and burn. That is the, at that time, some, what I should say, some information started coming, because very high power electrical transmissions were also creating some troubles, some interference in the human body and the human mind, some haziness in the mind, and some thinking also were getting getting thought. So they accepted the effect of magnetic field and electric field also. And that these field strengths and all were actually put in the standard till 2010. Next, please. And in 2010, they have given a full-fledged figure, that is a frequency dependence. And you can see here, this marker is moving over the plot, whatever I am moving.
No, I think that you can instruct and accordingly Deepti can move.
Okay, no, it will be difficult. I'll just tell, if you see in this plot, this left side envelopes, whatever we can see, these envelopes are actually electric and magnetic field and RF field also. And right side, it is high frequency side, how the electric and magnetic fields are, sorry, the microwave radiation standard is proposing. Here we can see that the for the professionals, as we can see, the frequency band of our interest is mostly around 1 to 10 gigahertz. That's what we are getting. Anyway, once this particular 5G communication is getting established, 28 and 39 gigahertz also will come. But as of now, we can tell that we are mostly getting exposed between a few, between around 500 megahertz to around 8 gigahertz up to 4G. Okay. So the center part of the figure, if you see, for the professionals, it is around 10 watts per square meter. The IEEE standard comes in comes in watts per square meter. If we transform it to milliwatts per square centimeter, it happens to be 1 milliwatts per square centimeter, correct? So for the professionals, earlier standard was 10 milliwatts per square centimeter. We are telling it is now 1 milliwatts per square centimeter. Next one, please. And for the common people, it is made 1/5. It becomes 0.2 milliwatts per square centimeter, very less. Okay, let us go to next. 2019 is the latest standard, whatever is evolved. Little bit it is changed, not a major change from the 2010. You can see for the professionals, it is kept at the same level of 1 milliwatt per square centimeter. And next, please. For the common people, it is kept as same, like 0.2 milliwatts per square centimeter. So one thing we have to keep in mind, this particular signal levels or microwave radiation levels, whatever is proposed by IEEE, do you feel it is a continuous exposure? It is not so. The standard is again for 10% exposure, 10% duty cycle exposure, like either in 1 hour's time, that means in 1 hour's time, total 6 minutes, you can afford to get yourself exposed to this type of radiation. And balance 90% of the time, you have to allow your body to work against this exposure and establish the equilibrium in your body through homeostasis. Whatever I have explained to you earlier, how homeostasis works. Is it very clear? Now, before going to further, if any questions are there, I would like to address it now.
Sir, I have one question. I don't know, means whether it will be okay or not. So for the common people and for the professionals, why the standard is different? I
yes. Not understand that one. Yes, correct, correct. You are, I think that question, when I'm coming to the next few slides, I'll be able to explain.
Okay, okay.
Fine. That is a very relevant question. That question will come, why it is separately done. Yes.
Yeah. Any other questions?
Can I ask one question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes. What I could see is, for persons who are exposed to X-rays, okay, for long time, specifically on cases where you want to X-ray various joints, suppose this thing. Mm. Suppose there's a big system where you want to make sure that everything is perfectly connected and done. So they will be exposed for a very long time for such things. So is there any standards for such X-ray working people?
X-ray working people, it is there. It is there in my second slide, as you have seen. Mm. For the professionals as well as for the common people, this X-ray or gamma ray exposures in terms of milli REM, I have told. Okay? And that is the total overdose. That is why what happens, this X-ray radiation, those who are even the technicians, they will be having one radiation badge.
Badge, yes, I've seen.
Yeah, that badge will be sent for the estimate every month to BRC. BRC is having a standard cell. And if it is seen that particular technician is getting exposed more, then he or she has to be given a break from that job in some other place for the balance part of the year. It is always done like that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah. Okay. Maybe we'll go. We'll come to the question answer next. I just want to know if anybody is having any doubt, whatever I have presented so far, Raghavan sir. We'll come back again.
Okay.
Okay. Next, please. No, microwave effects. This slide font is little small. I am really sorry for that. I have taken it from the IEEE standards. What I was telling you, now you yourself, some care you have to take against this radiation protection, whatever against the standards, whatever I have told you. Just try to go through this slide little carefully. If your body temperature goes beyond 42 degrees Celsius, let us say for the core temperature, and brain temperature beyond 40.5 degrees, heat stroke can take place. So you can think of that if you are using a mobile phone or some communication setup very close to your head, and you allow your body temperature to go up because of the microwave heating due to communication setup, obviously you will be facing some problem in your brain. You may feel little giddiness, you may feel nausea, other type of problems can come. So what our Professor Bhattacharya was telling, the technicians, let us say one radar technician who is working very close to the radar antenna. So usually what we do, that backlog of the radar antenna, we try to keep it as minimum as possible. Sometimes we keep it around 30 dB below or so. But let us say radar is radiating a power of around 10 kilowatts. Even 30 dB below, power would be quite sufficiently high at the backlog of the antenna. If some technician is working there, so he knows that he is getting exposed. So he has to take care when that's such a high power level. And some of the radar, some data is there, I will show you, that he has to take care that whenever he knows he is working under the backlog of the antenna, that he should take care, he should have proper protection whenever he is working. Most of the microwave community, most of us, maybe sometime or other, we have to work in front of an antenna or a communication set. So you have to take care as a professional. But common people will be far away. They will not be working in the close proximity of the antenna. So that is why. And they will be getting exposed due to regular radiation, whatever is around in the ambient. So it is has to be less for them. Because how long and what type of levels they are getting exposed, that they don't know. But still, Department of Telecommunication does the survey once in a while. And if it is found more, then they take action. I'll come to that next. Another thing, one more thing we have to remember, that our cell phones, it will be radiating, it will be transmitting also. When it is in the transmitting mode, it will be transmitting maximum power. So whatever SAR values it is telling, that is average SAR value for the cell phone. So actually radiation, whatever it is in the transmitting mode, it will not be within that SAR value or within that radiation value, whatever the manufacturer tells in the particular model in their manual or in the catalog. You try to avoid keeping it as far away from your chest. Some people will be keeping it in the chest pocket. It is very dangerous. Those who are keeping it in the pant pocket, just after this lecture, after a few months, you will start feeling that whatever I have put in this table, you just go to this third row, that is skin apoplosis, skin necrosis, full thickness burn and all. You will feel that if you are keeping your cell phone in a particular pocket continuously, at the end of the day, you will feel a mild change in the sensation of the skin of the particular area. You can feel yourself and you can come back to me later, whatever I have told, or you need not come back to me. You will accept, or you will be more cautious after this lecture is over and you see the effect, whatever I have told you. Go to the next. Again, let us see that Department of Telecommunication, they have given a standard for 900 megahertz. Usually when the standard was evolved, it was given the standard 400 to 2 gigahertz only. And 2 to 300 gigahertz also they have told it is 1 watts per square centimeter. That means 0.1 milliwatts per square centimeter. So that works out to be power density at 900 megahertz, something around 0.045 milliwatts per square centimeter for the common people. Nowadays, we see that so many cell phone towers are there around our society. Let us say that I go to a shopping complex, and at the top of the shopping complex, not just one cell phone tower, there may be having at least some five antennas, different service providers. If it is so, you just see this particular figure. Each transmitter of that particular cell phone tower power is somewhere around 20 watts, and typical gain is around 17 dB. So at a distance of 1 meter from that and one antenna, radiated power density is around 1 milliwatts per square centimeter, and it is continuous radiation. Okay, at a distance of 5 meter, it is around 0.3. At a distance of 10 meter, it is around 0.08. To think of 10 antennas are present and 10 such radiators are there, and 10 such signals are getting superimposed in your body. So at a distance of 5 meters, it will be 3 milliwatts per square centimeter. And if you are there for 2 hours, you are getting exposed to that type of radiation. It is really a matter of concern. Government is sometimes inspections are done. Our Professor Girish Kumar of IIT Mumbai has been doing some survey on this, and they have submitted some recommendation to Government of India. I don't know when government will take an action, and these towers are getting scattered instead of placing at a single location. Type of some decision has to be taken at the government level. Let us go to next. Then Government of India, for this telecom engineering center, they have evolved an act in 2012 by amending that Indian Telegraph Act 1885. Again, kudos to professor of IIT Mumbai that he somehow influenced the government and tried to keep this particular standard in vogue. That for head, it was given 0.791 watts per kg, and for whole body, it is 1.6 watts per kg. Whereas the European Union and USA, they are also following that 1.6 watts per kg for 6 minutes per hour. That is again 10% duty cycle in an hour. But our Government of India has not put such type of duration on that duty cycle of exposure. They have given it is average 1.6 watts per kg, whereas European Union and USA, they are keeping 1.6 watts per kg of SAR, but again it is for a duration of 6 minutes per hour. And when we talk about this particular SAR value acceptable or tolerable to our body, let us see the standard phones, whatever is popularly being used by many of us. Apple iPhone, it is 0.95 watts per kg. So 1.6 watts per kg for 6 minutes, and after that 54 minutes gap, not using any phone near your body. And you think of 0.95 watts per kg, many of us will be using Apple phone. And that also for continuous operation of half an hour, or sometimes our madams, you know how long they will be using the smartphones. And our kids also. And this iPad, people will be doing the net surfing in using the iPad very close to your body, keeping that phone, watching movie or watching or surfing the net, 0.76 watts per kg. And Xiaomi Mi 8, 1.32 watts per kg. That is really dangerous, that Xiaomi, Redmi phones. And Bluetooth, most of us are very fond of whenever we are driving, long drive or going to office by car, we'll be putting our things in the Bluetooth. What is the power? 2.4 gigahertz and 50 to 100 milliwatts per square centimeter. I think those who are using Bluetooth, they are really a danger. That is what is the information I am seeing everywhere. Next one, please. Yes, some of the FM radio stations. I was telling you earlier that FM frequency band is the most dangerous band, but absorption in the body is maximum. I have tried to put the stations throughout the India at different places. You see in Chandigarh, transmitted power is 0.05 kilowatts. New Delhi, 0.05 kilowatts again. Bangalore, 0.05 kilowatts. Mumbai, 20 kilowatts. Coimbatore, 10 kilowatts. That is the minimum. Bangalore, one more center is there, FM radio station, that is 10 kilowatts, Kolkata 20 kilowatts. So those who are within 1 kilometer of this particular antenna, FM radio stations, they are surely at danger. What type of danger? The time only will be able to tell us. Let us go to next. Military radars are far more dangerous. Okay, here you can see the military radars. Those who are operators, they are really at danger. Professor Girish Kumar, he created a big furor, and then we also have created some furor because this type of modules I have been teaching to the service people for last 5-6 years, and we have been sensitizing them. Now at least they have taken the details of this shielding material from us. Actually, EM shielding cloths are available. So they make some gown out of this this cloth, and they wear the gowns, these operators, whoever is there in the radar cabin or near to the antenna directly getting exposed, and they take care of themselves. Next, please. Domestic microwave ovens are not at all dangerous unless until your seal is getting spoiled. We can see the figure that compared to the used and new microwave ovens, used microwave oven is 0.08 milliwatts per square centimeter. And after the 2 to 14 years of usage also, it doesn't get degraded much. It is somewhere around 0.41 milliwatts per square centimeter. Not at all dangerous. And that also, the data is taken something around, let us say, 2 to 3 inch away from the microwave oven. And whenever microwave oven is on, you are not at least within 1 feet or 2 feet distance near the microwave oven. Nothing to worry much. And microwave cooking doesn't make the food. Just little bit, I'll digress to remove the boredom. Microwave cooking does not make the food radioactive. I think all of us know, but some people will be still feeling. So let us take it that dielectric heating it is, no side effects are there. Taste may little differ due to lack of roasting or lack of oxidation, but food quality remains same, vitamins are more preserved. And what is very important for microwave cooking, one big advantage of microwave cooking is that poisonous glycoalkaloids, most of us are very fond of potato, correct? And potato contains a glycoalkaloid called solanine. Solanine, even if you boil, even if you roast in the OTG, it doesn't get spoiled. But it is found that microwave cooking destroys the solanine almost by 30%. So microwave cooking is very effective in destroying the glycoalkaloids in many foods, not only potato, even some of the non-veg items also will be having this solanine. So after the food is cooked, whenever you are warming it microwave oven, that is really useful. Next one, please. Again, some military radars also I have put. These slides will be available to you. You can just go through it, how dangerous it is. But operators, obviously, they take care of themselves with some suitable microwave shielding gowns. But others coming somehow near to that are always at danger. Next, please. Now, I will quickly go through this Havana syndrome, what I was trying to tell you. This Havana, now we have understood that heating due to microwave can create lots of effects in our body. It may be short term, it may be long term also. But Havana syndrome is a short term syndrome by high power microwaves. Very high power, of the order of hundreds of microwatts of power, megawatts of power, is getting radiated for a few seconds or so. And if somebody gets exposed to it, then they will be having some physiological troubles. Next one, I'll come to that. I can skip this slide. This is for the active denial. Not a much to say. Then this HPM effects, see possible biological effects. It is hyperthermia. That is microwave heating. That is having negligible effect. Heating they may not be feeling because it is a very high power for a short duration, maybe a few pulses or a few bursts of pulses. It can create some RF shock or RF burn because high electric field is associated to it. See, so far we have been talking of around for cell phone towers or communications or Bluetooth. How much power? It is only a few milliwatts to few watts of power. Okay. So electric field will be very less. Electric field will be a few millivolts per meter or so. But when we go to megawatts of power, electric field would be sometimes around 1 kilovolts per meter and going up to 5 to 6 kilovolts per meter type of electric field. The equipments and the personnel will be subjected to. So it can cause RF shock and burn if I am getting grounded immediately after the exposure. Ocular disorder can happen, eye disorder, cardiac disorder can happen. Neurological disorder is very common. Habana syndrome is actually nothing but some neurological and cardiac disorder. Effects on bodily implants can happen. Effects of ornaments can happen. Let us go to next, please. RF shock and burn. High power microwave standards are still evolving, okay? And IEEE has not given any prescribed standards for that. Only IRPA has given some calculation and Boeing INC has given some calculations. That is International Radiation Protection Association, basically. So those things I just like to give you some idea about it. And plus Boeing, whatever they are telling. And risk is still inconclusive. Some research is always still going on. And when it will be concluded, we really don't know, because all the research in hyper microwaves are going on in a guarded, what I should say, as a guarded secret research. Now, let us say RF shock and burn, this formula if we use, given by IRPA calculation, okay, let us take an example that 175 centimeter tall human being, a standard human being, okay, exposed to 1 kilovolts per meter type of field at 2 gigahertz, usually what happens? What will be the body short circuiting current? Almost 550 ampere. This light is visible to everybody?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Visible. Almost 550 ampere. So 550 ampere, whatever may be the duration, let us say 550 ampere, we are getting exposed to the pulse duration. Let us say if it is around 70, 80 nanosecond. And the pulse train of, let us say, 50 hertz to 100 hertz pulse train. So in a second, some 550 ampere pulse with a pulse width of, let us say, somewhere around 70, 80 nanosecond, 50, 60 times or 100 times I am getting exposed. What will be the consequences? Nobody knows. Only we have to imagine from the biological experiments or biological phenomena was known to us, like, let us say, 150 milliampere for a few milliseconds, it is seen to create fibrillation of tissues causing cardiac arrest, then vesicular fibrillation or blockage observed in the human arteries, like we call the arterial blockages, or immediately have to go for the angioplasty and put a stent, so arterial blockage can take place. Then 200 volt for more than few milliseconds can cause inflammation of stratum corneum, that is burn injury. Our skin will feel some blisters are coming. That is one of the things whatever people follow in the ADS, that is some LIC, that is low intensity conflict control basically. Okay. Then just think of electroconvulsive therapy, that is a very crude method of treating the mental disorder. What they use? 130 volt only, 200 milliampere current, PRF is 140 over 300 millisecond. So you just see over 300 millisecond, 200 milliamperes of current is passing through our brain or around that particular part of the body for a PRF of 140 hertz. Okay. So you think of when we get exposed to a burst of 1 kilovolts per meter for 2 gigahertz with a short circuiting current of 550 ampere, what would be the response of our body? So these type of responses are nowadays called as the confusing response of the body or Habana syndrome. Next. The neural signal and cardiac rhythm, how it affects. See, You know that our neurons are not continuous channel, okay? One neuron to other neuron, there is a synaptic region gap is there. In that gap, the information is passed or signal is passed through the ion, that is sodium, potassium, and calcium ions. And that ions are actually sending the signal, whatever. These are all pulse modulation only. The signals are actually transmitted in terms of some voltage only, modulated voltage pulse, around 50 to 70 millivolt of impulse signals are transmitted from one nerve synapse to the other nerve synapse. So just you can think of such a high electric field, it will surely disrupt this type of nerve signals. You may feel that some sort of breathing trouble, you may feel that some sort of blackout, okay, some blurring in the vision, and some headaches, nausea, these are all part of the Havana syndrome. Then corneal and retinal injury, maybe permanent or maybe temporary also. And if it is becoming little higher, like 10 kilovolts per meter, somebody is getting exposed, then in the blood cell, our blood will be carrying some protein cells. Most of the protein cells are there in the blood also. These protein cells will get again in the form of a chain. Okay, they will get attached like a chain due to polarization. And this is called as pearl chain. Pearl chain, we know whatever our madams will be wearing. It will form a long pearl chain combination. And that may sometimes create trouble as a blockage in the arteries. And another problem can come with the pacemaker cells. That is, a pacemaker again, as we have seen in the beginning of this particular slide, that nerve impulses carry an impulse signal of around 50 to 70 millivolt. So pacemaker also require that type of signal to be given in that to the heart, okay, so that the heart muscles can work in the rhythmic fashion, both the sinoatrial and atrioventricular muscles. So that again can get disrupted and heart may start malfunctioning, and pacemaker again may not be able to pick up that rhythm subsequently. And many of you may know that when some open heart surgery is being done, at that time giving a impulse electrical signal, heart is first stopped. Before that, they put it ventilator, artificially the blood circulation is started in the body, then the heart is stopped. That is called cardioversion. The cardioversion, how much energy it needs only 2 joule per kg energy. Okay, so when our body gets subjected to sudden electromagnetic impulse, our heart even may get fully stopped and it may not again pick up. Okay, next one please. Okay, other than that, pacemaker starts malfunctioning. These are all studies, what I am telling, has been observed by Boeing Inc. Then hearing aids get spoiled. Then vesicular and prosthetic stents. Nowadays, stents are all made mostly using titanium, and some plastic stents are also there. But some stents are there which are apart from these metals also. Though those metals again get magnetized and creates other associated troubles subsequently. And ornaments. Boeing has seen that some engineers, those who have been operating, those who are wearing rings, or some lady officers, those who are wearing the bangles, after they got exposed to these electromagnetic high pulse impulses, black spots have come there, their skin is burned. Anyway, all this risk assessment is still inconclusive and some research is required. Next one, please. Now, coming to the conclusion, effects are mainly thermal. When I am going for continuous RF exposure, effects are mainly thermal, it is non-ionizing. Then homeostasis maintains the body temperature and metabolic balance. So let us keep homeostasis. It is the miracle in our body which is saving us. And radiation limit for common people is 0.2 milliwatts per square centimeter for 6 minutes per hour. Radiation limit for professionals, it is 1 milliwatts per square centimeter for, again, 6 minutes per hour. SAR for cell phones, less than 1.6 watts per kg. Again, it is safe for user for 6 minutes per hour. And radiation limit for telephone towers, it is 0.05 milliwatts per square centimeter at 900 megahertz. Now, military radars around the area is very unsafe. FM, All India Radio towers, very unsafe around that installations. Bluetooth radiation, better not to say anything. Those who are using, God only can save them. Then IRPA, IEEE, ANSI, okay, now they are proposing a standard, because as I was telling that so far whatever research is coming or people are talking about only one source or maybe a few sources. Now, worldwide, what we are seeing, there are number of service providers. There are several type of communications, and we are now present in a microwave ocean, as we can say. We are immersed in microwave ocean. So it is being proposed, maybe by 22, it is thought, or 23 it may go, that ANSI is trying to propose around 10 microwatts per square centimeter is the limit. Why they are able to tell is that they are telling now the fidelity of the receivers have improved appreciably. So with very low power, we would be able to manage. Such a high power transmission or high power receiving is not required. Number of microwave transmission channels can be reduced. And when we go to the higher frequency, fidelity can be further improved. Antenna gain can be further improved. Like 5G, if we go to 28 gigahertz or 39 or 43 gigahertz, antenna gain can be appreciably increased, and focused antenna. That type of thinking is going on. Let us see. But that you have to see when the 5G comes. And another point of advantage of 5G is those frequencies won't penetrate in your body inside the limbs. It will be all hitting your skin, maybe a few hundreds of microns, not beyond the skin. Inside your body, it won't penetrate, because skin depth will be very less for high frequency signals. So 5G will be a savior, of course, that you have to see how it goes and how quickly we can switch over towards 5G. Next one, please. Then EMP exposure, again, Boeing standard, or that ICI NIRP standard, is that electric field is 1 kV per meter and magnetic field is 5 ampere per meter. And IRPA even given a standard for common public also. So whenever these electricity boards or that type of high power transmission lines are put around, they take care of that particular standard. Next one, please. So we have, nobody can save us if we don't save ourselves. And those who are professionals, I would request them that those who are working around the X-ray environment, like somebody is testing very high power microwave tubes, or around the transmitter having tetriodes or tetrodes, some high electron, high energy electrons will be hitting the copper or tungsten targets. Some X-rays will be generated. So X-ray shields, please ensure around you. And those who are working around the radars or communication setups, getting continuous exposure beyond these limits, please wear some jackets made of wire mesh, okay? Or some electromagnetic shield, the cloth is available around 80-90 dB shielding, and some goggles are available for EM shielding. That type of arrangements you have to make for yourself. I think with this, I would like to conclude, and thanks to everyone for a very patient hearing. Now I think I can open it for any question.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful presentation and wonderful talk. Yeah, so it's over to all the audience. So the, as sir has told, that he is ready to face the questions. So those who are having the questions, so at that time, Professor Raghavan, you were asking something.
Please. Yeah, yes, yes.
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Yes. Yeah. It was very interesting to hear your new comment, Gandhi standards. So I'm using that book, Biological Effect of Microwaves by O.P. Gandhi. Only through you I come to know you as in CD. I would like to know, is there any separate division on biological effect of microwaves in CD or measurement, or what made him write that book?
No, I don't think that he has done the work in India. He has done the work after going to US. I think Professor Basu has joined. He may be able to tell little more on Professor Gandhi. But whatever work he has done in US. And he was part of this particular standard formulation along with IEEE.
Very proud to see Dr. V.N. Basu, who might have worked along with O.P. Gandhi.
Yes, he has worked. I think I would prefer Professor Basu to tell about Professor Gandhi.
Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Please go ahead.
Okay. I didn't see myself. I saw Professor Gandhi once, and Padibai at CIMT, Electronics Engineering Department. You have a book. There is a library where you can see a book, Microwave Engineering, by O.P. Gandhi. Okay, and before writing my book entitled Electromagnetic Theory and Applications in Beam Wave Electronics under the imprint of World Scientific, I used to discuss with Professor Gandhi regarding the topic selection. So he is a great scholar, and then he, Professor S. Raghavan, wanted to know whether he did some work at Syria or not. No. As Subroto Dr. Dutta told, he did that work in USA. I forgot the, I'm not getting the name of the university, but I know they are very famous for doing work in the area of biomedical engineering. I think you can get from the website. What is that called? Google, you can find out. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Then I have a couple of questions. Probably I can discuss at the end. Somebody else may have some questions.
Yeah, I can see that Mr. Ardendu Kundu, you have raised your hand. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. Sir, actually, I have a couple of questions. The first one is that you told that from the BMR to SAR ratio, it's coming, that is the whole body SAR, that is 0.4 watt per kilogram, possibly the 30% from 1.2 watt per kilogram. So, sir, I have a doubt that that is for the whole body average SAR, but when we are talking about SAR average over 1 gram of contiguous tissue, that is 1.6 watt per kilogram, so then how this standard is evolving for that one average over 1 gram of contiguous tissue, that is 1.6 watt per kilogram.
Okay. See, the moment they talk about that average and the tolerable limit, okay, the two things are there. When I was presenting, you must have seen that is some 30% overhead above the tolerable limit of BMR, that is the tolerable limit. So 0.4 is working out with respect to that. Then, whatever microwave signals are getting, our body is getting exposed to, again, only effective 50% is getting absorbed in the body. So another 50% overhead we are getting. So let us say 0.4, we go to 0.8. Now,
okay,
understood? That is, but
yes, sir.
Again, the question is, it is getting a limit of around 0.8. Correct.
Right.
Not 1.6. 1.6, they can double of that. Now they are doing a time averaging basically. They are telling that either if you are go for somewhere around 0.4 to 0.8 watts per kg type of tolerable limit, if you are getting a continuous exposure. So that is why for common people, when a common person is getting continuous exposure, they are reducing it. Apart from that. Now, IEEE is telling that, again, if it is a continuous exposure, either the level should be sufficiently low so that your body homeostasis is not getting disturbed, or you have to give some time to body to get, again, create the equilibrium. That's why they are telling that double of 0.8, that is 1.6 watts per kg,
okay,
type of limit is tolerable if you are having only 10% duty cycle of exposure.
Okay, sir. Sir, a related question is that I was opening the ICNIRP guideline, which is pretty much similar to IEEE. So
actually, ICNIRP and IEEE and ANSI, all three units have been working together. Okay, and because IEEE things are well, IEEE is having a very good network, so that C95.1 is getting most popularized. More or less, it is same standard. Not much of it.
Actually, sir, in the ICNIRP guideline, if we open the latest version in 2020, there we can see that these limits are there, along with that there are some notes where it is written that 1.6 watt per kilogram SAR averaged over 1 gram, in ICNIRP it is basically 2 watt per kilogram of SAR, in FCC it is 1.6 watt per kilogram, but basically that is averaged over 6 minutes of time span, but the fact that you have told that it is within an hour, only 6 minutes of time span. That is not given as a note. It is given only that it is averaged over 6 minutes of time span.
Mm-hmm. No. Maybe so, maybe somewhere else they must have told. Maybe before that, prior to that, somewhere they must have already specified. Okay, that's why everywhere they are not going explicitly mentioning that. But it is like that. It is 10% duty type of operation.
Okay, sir. And sir, means, can I get 2 more minutes, sir?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sure.
Actually, sir, basically in ICNIRP 2020 guideline, there are some they have evolved some of the techniques. Like they have introduced another new term, that is absorbed power density beyond 6 gigahertz. Because earlier in the earlier version, it was a specific absorption rate limit which was defined for up to 6 gigahertz. But now people are thinking and people are working on 5G and 6G communication. So because of that reason, we need to talk and we need to think about the radiation hazards beyond 6 gigahertz. So that's why they have introduced a new term, that is absorbed power density from SAR beyond 6. So means why they need to switch it from SAR to absorbed power density? Because I really couldn't understand from the...
This part of it, I have deliberately skipped it because again, it goes to pure microwave. Okay, this particular talk, I have actually made a module for not microwave people. I see what happens. I was just mentioning that whenever we are switching over to 5G, or we are going to the high power microwave effects at millimeter waves, what happens? The type of frequency you just see and conductivity of the body tissues you just see. Okay, what will happen? Skin depth will be hardly a few hundreds of micrometers, maybe some 200, 300 microns. Okay.
Yeah.
So yes, it will be basically at the skin level heating, it will not penetrate inside the body. Even signal will not even will be penetrate your skull and reach the brain cells. It may not even reach your heart muscles also. It will be all at the at this subcutaneous, at the most cutaneous level interactions. Okay. So whenever we talk about whole body SAR, that is specific absorption rate, and we tell it average SAR, with the body considering a continuous tissue with some particular conductivity. So that type of concept will not be able to be made valid for the full body when you go for the higher frequencies. That is why there is a need to change the concept. That will work out. People, those who are evolving the standards, I think they are going in the right direction. They are all learned people. So
right.
We'll know more maybe when it is made popular.
And sir, there are different guidelines worldwide, like FCC, ICNIRP, IEEE, and there are different national guidelines, like in Switzerland, Italy, etc. So, if we go through different guidelines, basically there are lot of discrepancies among the guidelines.
Yes.
So, how to make a uniform guideline worldwide? Means, is it possible, or are scientists working on this?
See, I'll tell you. You are talking of that uniform guideline of a standard.
Yes, okay. Sir. Means SAR limit and the reference power density.
Okay, it is quite possible if everybody accepts. But you see, even for this simple, that mechanical threading, okay, worldwide there is no unified threading. For electrical power transmission, no unified standard is there. Okay, maybe sometimes it will happen. It hardly matters whichever country is following one standard, at least some standard is there, people are using it.
And sir, one final question, that is, sir, means what about means all the guidelines that we have developed? These are primarily based on the effects on human. But sir, we are doing some primary research on effects of radiation, microwave radiation on plants as well. So we have some initial results which we have published recently from Jadavpur University. So means, is there any chance to consider the bio effects, especially the at the molecular level, like gene expression change, etc., on plants? So is there any scope of consideration the effects on plants?
See, bio, this whatever research you are doing, I hope you are doing, you have been taking some biomarkers and bioreceptors and you are seeing the effects through them, if I am not wrong, correct?
Yeah, sir, basically we are working on some stress sensitive gene expressions, which are similar to if we give some electrical stimulation to some plants or some other stress like situation, then basically how they react, or those genes are expressing by upregulation or downregulation, and accordingly whether the EM exposure that is also stimulating similar type of upregulation or downregulation.
I was stress sensitive gene. Similar thing means if you are using some markers or that type of some some parameters, if that type of parameters, if you can identify for plants, I think you can do that. Why not? You have to see. I am not that expert in that particular thing. Maybe some experts in OS Institute or somewhere, you can just find out and talk to them, possibly.
May I join you? Okay. I will suggest Dr. Arvindu to interact with Professor S.P. Singh of IIT BHU. He was doing some collaborative work in the area of microbiological effects with some professor in the Department of Zoology. So I think Dr. Somak can help you in getting contact of Professor Singh.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Okay. Yeah, thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you.
Incidentally, if Somak allows me.
Yes, please go ahead, sir.
If others have no, others may have some questions. Please, then I will say some my comments or some questions, some basic questions. I think Professor.
Yeah, Professor Raghavan, you want to say something?
No, only 1 minute with your permission.
Yes.
So, Dr. O.P. Gandhi is from Utah University. Just for the information of Professor Basu.
Yeah,
he's from Utah University. Thanks a lot.
Which university, please repeat?
Utah. Salt Lake.
University of Utah.
He joined Utah, by the way. Sorry.
Thank you.
He joins Utah. And from Utah, I think he wrote that book, Microwave Engineering. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
It's an excellent book. It is available in BHU IIT Library. IIT Electronics Engineering Library. Okay.
Yeah, maybe we can take one or two quick questions from others.
Yeah.
Students, especially the way I ask the students who are working in this field, please go ahead. This is your unique opportunity to interact with Dr. Dutta. Please go ahead. Anyone from the microwave tube division, anyone of the students that were working in the microwave tube area, you can ask. Yes. Rajarshi, you want to ask something? Hello, Rajarshi. Okay, I believe no one is asking, so may I? Yes, so. Yeah, so I believe that, yeah, Professor Basu, you can go ahead for your comments for the time being. Yeah.
Okay, before making my comments.
Just excuse me. Yeah. Or Ardhendu, can you please just make your hand down? Your hand is still up. That from the, yeah, thank you. Yes, Professor Basu, please.
May I continue?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. There is one mention about Professor Girish Kumar. I think Professor Raghavan knows him very well. And Girish Kumar, I invited Girish Kumar to Mankundu. There is a college. Brother Dr. Dutta has visited a number of times. So I invited him to give a lecture on this, on the subject which Dr. Dutta Subrata was speaking on. One technical question. I guess I came a bit late. I was in another program. So I think definition, basic question. Definition of SAR, specific absorption rate, Dutta might have given, I'm not sure, because I've not seen the slides. He might have given in terms of specific heat, temperature increase, and exposure duration. Am I correct?
Correct.
Just is my guesswork, intuitive guess, because I have not seen your slide. But there is another definition, that is in term electrical definitions, that is defined as conductivity sigma times magnitude electric field square,
whole
divided by mass density.
Correct.
So my theoretical question is, can you deduce one from the other? A problem, a basic theoretical.
I think should be possible. We have to try.
Okay. Now coming to the comments, probably Professor Dr. Dutta has forgotten that he was our student. M.Tech student, and maybe he has forgotten that. Does he remember that? M.K. student and Ph.D. student also, or BHU, IIT, BHU.
I don't forget. How I will forget it?
That's your fine. Thank you. Remember, I was giving. He did some work in the area of, what is that? Eulerian dynamics, nonlinear effects in TWTs using Eulerian dynamics. And then he did that work. M.Tech work was completed. Then he wanted some PhD problem. And then he said, I want to continue the same problem. I said, I cannot take a risk. I have to ask the world experts. So I was one world expert, Dr. R.G. Carter of Lancaster University. He told me that people tried Eulerian dynamics. Normally they do Lagrangian mechanics. But they tried Eulerian dynamics, but they could not succeed. But Professor Basu, your student, probably can do it. And he can probably do. Then I said, I cannot take the risk, Dutta. It changed the topic, because PhD, I cannot take risk, because my 3 years and not more than that. Only one can stay for 3 years and get out with a PhD degree. Then he says, no, sir. Dutta said, you can, in a email letter, he can probably do it. He wrote to me. No, he wrote to that thing, I will do it. He took the risk, took the challenge, and did that work and published a number of papers in that. Then another thing I want to share about Dr. Dutta, one of his papers was accepted in IEEE Transactions on Electron Devices, and it probably went to the press. Then he came, he called me from Bangalore, that said, I want to withdraw that paper. I said, why? Because I gave one data and I work with that, that is regarding the structure loss, lump loss or distributed loss, there's something wrong.
Distributed loss.
Yes. And so I want to withdraw that paper. That paper was accepted. And he withdrew that. They said you send it within some limit they'll give. But he had a lot of work pressure at MTRDC, DRDO lab. So, but he could not do it. So it took 1.5 years probably to get that paper published again. So this is the kind of, another thing I regard him very much, he was ranked sixth in the higher secondary examination of West Bengal Board. That is the highest qualification to me, that is the highest qualification he has got, not his PhD. Okay. And another thing, I am proud that I am a good teacher, because Dr. Datta is my student. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your very affectionate and kind words.
In fact, it's a strong motivation for, especially for all the students that who is listening to, especially to Professor Basu now, I should say, rather, that who has especially made those kind of comments about his own student, Dr. Datta. Okay, and I believe the students are really, who are present over here, they really can get carried over, or they can be motivated by from this particular speech and your this information. And thank you very much, sir, for this nice presentation. And for
if you allow me, this is a group, I can just advertisement sort of thing.
Yeah,
Professor
yeah.
Raghavan is going to lead our next webinar in the area of indigenous development of software for vacuum electron devices. Okay, and that will be held in November, late November. So he has taken the lead. In fact, his student, there is a student, Swapnil Gaur. He has got a company, and he claims that he has developed a software which can match CST. Okay, so Professor Raghavan is the credit goes to him for motivating us to arrange that one. That will be done by IEEE Rajasthan subsection. Okay, sometime in the late, so that I know then the DRDO people can freely join that subcenter rather than a WhatsApp group, you know. That was the main idea. Thank you very much.
Swapnil also is a close friend of Dr. Somik Bhattacharya.
Okay.
Initially, they used to conduct with us.
I was not knowing. So we want to encourage him. Swapnil Gaur. Yes, we want to encourage him. Thank you.
And in fact, before we wind up, let me just tell to all the students, in fact, we are going to advertise in a couple of days that in the next week, that is in the first week of October, in fact, those who are doing this IEEE activities, they might aware of, it is the IEEE Day celebration. And the IEEE MDT Student Branch Chapter IIT BHU, in fact, this time we are having the theme of, especially this has been coming from the students, especially that how to write the papers. And let me tell you that we are having that we are very much fortunate to have two speakers, and one of them is present over here, Professor B.N. Basu. Okay, he's going to talk. And on the very next day, Professor Pankaj Kumar Chaudhary, the current editor-in-chief of Journal of Electromagnetic Waves and Applications. So both of them will share their experience about the research paper writing, and the students, they will share their, you know, that how to make the documentations in some cases, or how to make the figures. So it will be, in fact, in four slots we are planning, and the advertisement will come up very soon. So once it will be done, I will just request that all the student members who are, or all the students who are present over here, please attend, and please tell your friends that who are just, you know, they're just there entering in this particular field of research, to attend that particular workshop completely free of cost. Okay, and you will be very fortunate to listen from Professor Basu as well as from Professor Chaudhary, I believe. So this is a very good opportunity for all of you. So thank you, Dr. Sir, for the wonderful lecture once again from our
thank
side.
Thank you.
And thank you, Basu Sir, from your extremely busy schedule. In fact, you are having another meeting. And let us, in fact, take this.
I'm going to join that meeting again.
Yeah, sure. So before you join, in fact, just let us take 10 seconds. Let me take this opportunity to congratulate Professor Basu in this particular forum. He has been nominated as IET Lifetime Achievement Award. Okay, so we should congratulate him.
Congratulations.
So, in fact, this is a big, in fact, and I don't know, in fact, how I can tell this one, because once I had joined IIT BHU, I have been offered the same office where Professor Basu used to sit.
Yes, yes.
So it's a big burden for me, let me tell you very honestly. And I told the then HOD that why you are allocating me this room? Because I and in fact, I can recall that for the next 1 year, I even didn't have the any kind of dare to remove his nameplate. Because I thought that, well, it is not, I can't do that because it will be a kind of, you know, it will be a sin for me. Okay, I can't do that. Then, yeah, obviously with the advent of time and with due to some other official things, yes, means gradually his name was removed and my name had come up in front of my office. But yes, but I feel myself very lucky to have to, you know, to acquire the same. Yeah.
Thank you. I am also elevated by your occupation.
So thank you, Dr. Sir, once again for the
Thank you all of you for a very kind and patient hearing. And my pranam to Professor Basu for his very kind and affectionate words. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
We will meet you again for your next webinar. Please put me in the list. I would like to join.
Sure, sir. Thank you. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you, sir.